soon as she stepped out of the TARDIS, Amy Pond's knees buckled and she crumpled into a heap.
You weren't joking about the gravity, were you?
The doctor poked his head out of the police box's doors and sighed at the sight of Amy struggling to stand up.
Do you ever listen to what I say? He asked, pausing to acclimatize to the gravitational forces of this new world before propelling himself forward.
Standing beside Amy, the doctor reached down and hauled her back to her feet.
Look before you leap. First rule of time travel, after never dating your own ancestors. I'm not making that mistake again.
Yeah, okay.
Amy held tightly to the doctor's arm and fought the urge to sit down and have a nap.
I just didn't expect it to be so difficult to walk. Well, at least you've shown your husband how not to do it, said the doctor, before letting his head drop at the heavy whoomph behind them.
They turned to see Rory scrambling in the dirt, just inches from the TARDIS.
Rory, said Amy with a sly smile, don't you ever listen to what the doctor says.
But Rory still wasn't listening. He was just staring up from where he'd tumbled, mouth wide open.
Wow.
The doctor grinned, nodding his appreciation.
That's the reaction you want when you take someone to a new planet, the doctor exclaimed,
trying to throw out his arms in a dramatic gesture, which was tricky in the heavy gravity.
Wow, indeed, Rory. Wow, wow, wow.
Amy had to admit that her boys were right. The vista that spread out before them was incredible, even in the half-light of the huge silver moon. In the far distance, a line of jagged black cones jutted up into the sky, smoke belching from their peaks, while dark grey clouds crawled against the blackness of space high above them, almost, but not quite, hiding clusters of dancing stars.
This is planet CRHX-756J, began the doctor absently,
his attention focused on a rough track in the dust.
At least, officially. The colonists who came here from Earth called it Hope Eternal. Colonists, repeated Amy. They're brave. I mean, spectacular and everything, but this can't be the easiest place to set up home.
It isn't, the doctor agreed, following the path of the track to the edge of the sheer drop. Hope Eternal is a super-Earth, a planet just a teeny bit larger than your own. Heavy gravity, volcanoes galore, and a crust rammed with mineral deposits. And you know humans, wherever there's something valuable to dig up, they break out the spades.
Ah.
A mining colony, then, said Rory, trying not to appear breathless as he trudged over to join Amy and the doctor, unaware that they weren't even listening. Instead, the pair were staring intently down the slope of loose scree. There, in the valley below, lay a body, face down in the dirt. The doctor was off without another word, scooting down towards the ominously still figure. Amy shot a look at her husband before taking after the doctor.
What is it?
She asked as she reached the bottom, followed by Rory, who careered down the incline to land in a groaning heap.
It,
the doctor replied angrily, sitting on his haunches and staring at the squat body.
He is dead. That's what he is. Very, very dead.
Sorry, said Amy meekly, leaning on the doctor as she knelt beside him.
What killed him?
With a grunt, the doctor rolled the figure onto his back. It was humanoid, about the size of the silverback gorillas that Amy had fallen in love with on those childhood visits to Bristol Zoo. The sleeves of its navy blue overalls were rolled up to reveal extraordinarily long arms, covered in thick, purple scales. Amy watched as the doctor respectfully closed the creature's sightless eyes, and then her gaze fell down to the charred hole that gaped in the middle of its chest.
Focused energy beam to the chest at point-blank range, suggested the doctor. I imagine his internal organs baked immediately. Then he was dumped out here.
How can you tell?
The tracks by the TARDIS. Something heavy was dragged to the edge and then toppled over.
Doctor, said Rory quietly.
That's horrible,
Amy shivered.
Murder usually is, agreed the doctor.
Doctor,
said Rory again, now more urgently.
All right, Rory, snapped the doctor, whipping out his sonic screwdriver. He buzzed it over the scorched wound to confirm his diagnosis. Pond, go help your husband up. I'm a tad busy, right?
His voice trailed off when he glanced up and saw what Rory had been trying to point out. Something was rushing through the air towards them. Something large, with gargantuan wings. But all their eyes were on its huge, gaping mouth and massive, razor-sharp teeth. Amy knew she should run, yet she was rooted to the spot. Not by the high gravity, but by absolute terror. The creature shrieked as it dived straight for them. Doctor Who, The New Humans, by Cavan Scott and Mark Wright. Read by Raquel Cassidy. Somebody slammed into Amy, knocking her to the ground. She felt the rush of air as the monster shrieked past, heard a dull, wet thud as its jaws closed on something, on someone, and listened to the sound of its monstrous wings as it swept back into the air. Are you okay? She looked up into the concerned eyes of Rory, who had pushed her out of the way and landed awkwardly on top of her. She rewarded him with a kiss before snapping her head back suddenly. The creature had missed her, but it had caught someone. The doctor? When you two have finished, the doctor said from somewhere behind them, we're not out of the woods quite yet. Where's the body? Amy asked as Rory helped her to her feet. Our friend must have been hungry, the doctor confirmed. Probably a scavenger, used to scooping up whatever carrion it can find. How can something that big fly in this gravity? Asked Rory, brushing fragments of rock from Amy's arm. It's all to do with how dense air behaves in high gravity situations. Thanks to all of these volcanoes. The doctor stopped himself. Let's just say it's science stuff that we haven't got time for right now.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.